Hello, honey. Welcome to the special episode of Tagata Pasifika.
Well, as we all know, it was an unusual year for all of us with the lurking threat of COVID-19. But for our team here at Tagata Pasifika, the show went on.
That's right. So let's take a look back at some of the highs and lows of 2020. Here's Anauli Karima Fai'ai.
2020 kicked off like any other year, as we endeavoured to showcase people from all walks of life doing big things in our communities.
You may have heard the term, the sky's the limit. Well, that's what these Tangaroa College students live by, because they're about to embark on a special assignment.
Our principal and our board of trustees have allowed me to take four of my Year 10 students to space camp in Huntsville, Alabama. I was just totally blown away. Like, I didn't know what to expect, really. We're not really into the space zone in New Zealand as they are in America. Like, it's just part of their curriculum. Like, they love the race.
Making changes at home was one thing, but how would he cope being a vegan in the army where he holds a staff sergeant's rank in the territorials?
I think people get quite surprised when I tell them I'm vegan, definitely in my role in the army. And they're really good around supporting my vegan lifestyle or life. There's always a meal for me. If I don't have a meal, then they'll hurry up and try and get something for me. Last time they begged to give a whole lot of lettuce or something like that, they put down vegan with a big heart.
And of course, sports stories are always a favourite, and we caught up with athletes in New Zealand and abroad.
In 2016, I was diagnosed with a rare form of cancer, adrenal cancer. I thought everything was good. We had a successful surgery, and in 2018, I got the news that it had returned, and it's now returned back in the lungs, which is the worst place probably that you want it to come to.
Andrea is not letting the disease stop her from pushing her mental and physical limits. She will compete in indoor rowing, shot put, discus, swimming and powerlifting.
I think the discipline I've tried to instill here is it's almost like a military discipline. And I've been criticised in the past for being too hard.
In Samoa, we followed the Samoa Victim Support Group to give us an update on the measles situation and how affected families are coping post-outbreak.
Because of the measles, it's something that it just happened. It wasn't anything that was expected or something that... So you will see the financial situations that the family are in, and they were not prepared for it.
Lealva, a resident Seilonga Setiu, had two children affected by measles. Only one survived. A two-year-old still battling health complications, which has taken a financial toll on the family. Meanwhile, countries around the world were struggling to keep a stranglehold on the coronavirus, and fears were beginning to surface in New Zealand.
Can I just note then, you said when. Yeah, this is not an if, this will come into our communities.
Yes, most definitely. I mean, if you compare it to the measles, you know, that was really difficult. And dealing with the huge numbers, and especially in South Auckland, because most of the numbers were here in South Auckland that we dealt with, it was really, you know, it was quite busy for us. We know that it's only a matter of time that it will hit our population, and so, you know, we need to make sure we prepare them well.
Before long, the virus had reached New Zealand, leading to cancellations of both the Auckland Polyfest and Pasifika Festival.
A lot of disappointment. I think especially for stallholders, a lot of people have put a lot of money in it. Why do they have to be cancelled just the day before? Why not a week before they, you know, went out and bought the supplies and stuff like that?
Yeah, I guess it comes down to, you know, like it's a day-by-day thing that we're dealing with regarding coronavirus and precautionary measures that need to be taken. So absolutely, it's an inconvenience, it's a disappointment for our communities, especially the stallholders. But I guess you've got to weigh up the economic loss versus the potential of loss of life, which is what weighed heavily on the Mayor and the Prime Minister's minds when they made this call.
Things began to shift very quickly over the coming weeks as the number of COVID cases continued to grow. The country was preparing for the worst.
With the Pasifika Day and Polyfest already cancelled and a ban on large crowds in place, churches are coming under pressure to do the same.
The message from the head of the church in Samoa
that we better think of, and if they cancel, they can cancel it.
The Mormon Church has already cancelled services, but some, like the Catholic Church, are continuing for now, but with changes.
Am I allowed to shake your hand?
While a nationwide shutdown hasn't been announced, teachers are readying their students for online learning, should they have to stay home.
For our teachers, they've worked really hard over the last couple of weeks teaching the children about the coronavirus and measures that they can take to protect themselves, washing their hands, sneezing into their to elbow. So we've sent letters home that just outlines the severity of the situation we're in New Zealand.
While New Zealand was far better off than most affected countries, the government ultimately announced a nationwide level 4 lockdown as part of their strategy to go hard and go early.
This level has been activated because it is now likely that the COVID-19 disease is not contained. The two major risks we now need to manage are first, sustained and intensive transmission, and secondly, widespread outbreaks.
Stay with us after the break, coping under COVID lockdown restrictions.
Coming to you from my home here in Otahuhu.
By late March, the entire country was in level 4 lockdown, and when everyone had to make some big adjustments, including our presenters who had to brush up on their camera skills so they could film themselves at home.
Well, as you can see, it's a new look show again. A 4-week lockdown means I'm coming to you from my home or my bubble here in Otahuhu.
The stay-at-home rule was strictly enforced, but everyone found ways to keep themselves entertained over the 4-week period.
People are getting out, utilising that opportunity to get in some exercise, but also making sure they keep that 2-metre distance. I myself have been out running, and we are here in Lyell Bay, and unfortunately over the last couple of days, there have been a number of surfers in the water catching some waves, but that has been frowned upon by authorities. But it seems like today that they have got that message and there are no surfers in the water.
However, it was also a challenging period for many in our Pacific communities dealing with job losses and pay cuts.
I guess it's a little bit of a split marama. We're hearing that the communities are responding in some really positive ways. They're coming together, checking on vulnerable people, the elderly. That's really cool to see. But the other side that we're seeing probably more so is families and people who are worried, very anxious, very fearful, really concerned about the future, but also the immediate needs. So it's a little bit different, but I think the concerns are really interesting and hard to see.
Across the country, people rally to support those in need.
Here at the Wellington City Mission, demand on services has skyrocketed.
In the last 7 days following lockdown, we gave out 329 food bags. And that's 4 times the weekly average that we would normally distribute. So that shows, I think, the heightened need that has arisen out of the financial impact of COVID-19.
Hawke's Bay, a normally bustling region, is now all but silent. But here on a Monday morning in Napier...
Hey guys, all these are ready to go in here now.
These essential workers are out on a special mission.
We're the packers for today. We're just bagging up all the food to go in the boxes. We're going to go to the Kmart or first, and then get distributed to the rest of the people on today's list.
Over in the islands, we looked at how they were coping with COVID-19 and the measures they were taking to keep their citizens safe.
On the beat to protect their country, Fiji authorities continue the fight against the latest global enemy, COVID-19.
In a situation like we are in, we first of all would like to contain the damage. While research is going on for a medical counter.
French Polynesia's capital is usually a bustling town centre. These days, Papeete is empty. The country's schools, shops and main resorts and hotels have been closed for over a month now, a necessary measure to stop the spread of the COVID-19 virus.
One of the important things that we have to remember is that early contact tracing is really important. That's what helps us contain the epidemic. The other thing as well is in terms of the measures that have been put in terms of restriction.
So I don't think anyone on this island has any immunity, natural immunity to the COVID.
Samoa is currently reliant on sending suspected cases for testing to Aotearoa.
The aim is that by mid-April, Samoa will have the capability to conduct tests in country.
In late April, the government announced a shift to alert level 3, which means we could move away from Zoom interviews and venture into the community to see how businesses were managing post-lockdown.
Like many small businesses across the country, Mark is relieved to be able to head back to work under alert level 3 conditions.
We just emailed everyone out and just told them that we were back on the books today. And we know a lot of people have suffered financially, so we just put out there that we were able to offer people a 10% discount if they had somewhere for us to place the grass, and amazing response.
With New Zealand's borders still closed and limited flights to the Pacific, Jackie admits it's been hard, but still has clients overseas and in the Pacific to look after.
To be honest, the lockdown was kind of similar to when we began, because you're worried about, are we going to make it? Everything had just stopped. So we had to think quickly on how we could assist our Pacific Island customers and get freight over there for them so they could keep going.
It was business as usual for most of us, but many low-income workers continue to suffer.
For 40 years, Emil Fruin has dedicated most of his life to working here at Temperzone.
I've just turned 60. I wanted to retire here. I thought I was going to retire here, but it's not to be.
Now he's on the other side of the fence with fellow workers picketing because of how they were treated during the COVID-19 lockdown.
It was really unfair the way the company had gone about doing everything to us. And then when we get back, you know, less than 3 weeks later, we're told 85 of us are being made redundant.
Among the affected are the contracted cleaners for Auckland Council, who had their services suspended when the lockdown commenced. Many were living on just 80% of their income.
We did a calculation that was below the minimum wage. It was about $15.20 or something that we realised. So no wonder they were struggling in paying their bills and everything, yeah.
While many continued to lose their jobs, there were also stories of those who managed to get back on their feet, like Tongan pilot Henele Vete.
Fortunately for Henele, he didn't have to look far. With the help of his sister, he happily took a job stocking shelves at Bunnings in Howick.
When Bunnings gave me that job, my sister was worried that I might not like it. I love what I do. Back in the days when I was still flying, it's already a preparation the day before. But going to Bunnings, I don't need to do that preparation. I'm actually stress-free. I just wake up in the morning, I look forward to going to work, and all I do is just follow what the leader does, tells me to do.
Even the lockdown didn't stop the men from taking part in their fitness regime. They all joined the group workout from their own bubble.
Nice work, nice work.
The men who signed on came from all walks of life and with their own health challenges.
I used to have a few medical issues. Being tired of being going to the hospital, I decided to, change my life.
After the break, Auckland goes back into lockdown and we revisit our coverage of the New Zealand general election.
How dare people disrespect my husband like that?
At alert level 1, Kiwis were able to return to some sense of normality. For us at Tagata Pasifika, and we could once again catch up with inspiring people in our communities.
For the last 10 years, Shakela Welese has been playing at hospitals and rest homes.
I play the piano. I visit different rest homes depending on where I am. I just ask to come in and volunteer and give some entertainment. I try to play to the audience, so I'll play 50s and 60s music. And I enjoy when I hear them sing along because they're quite old songs.
Building his dream business has been tough, which is why Christian relies heavily on his faith and his family for support and encouragement.
Working three jobs and everything, like my family helps out heaps because I'm allowed to come home and do my hustle. My little brother, Simeon and Christopher, they're always sharing my stuff. My parents, aunties, uncles, they work so hard for me to have the opportunity to do stuff like this. None of this is possible without my family.
While COVID-19 has been the focus for many of our stories this year, during Alert Level 1 we were able to explore other issues affecting our communities.
It's a difficult time in any young woman's life when they first get their period. And at school there's an added pressure when students have to worry about having enough sanitary products to last the day.
Attendance is really important, but sometimes when it comes to having your period at school, it's just a learning barrier. Like sometimes you either think to yourself, oh, I need to go home or I need to buy a pad.
School brawls among Auckland's high schools is not a new issue, but recent incidents have brought it back to the forefront.
any fight, whether it's weaponised or not, are taken seriously by the police. The schools where these students come from, and they're only a small minority, and the images are tarnished by the actions of the small minority.
In August, we began our September elections coverage, interviewing the leaders of the Conservative and Green parties.
Tell us about where you stand in terms of homosexuality.
Well, homosexuality is someone's psychological reaction to a whole raft of different areas. In terms of homosexuality, we don't actually have much to say about it. What we do say is that the best place for a young person to be raised with being resilient, choosing good things, is in a married mum and dad home.
What do you say to people out there that who say you're rewarding, you know, parents for having children if they can't afford it and suddenly they're going to be getting all this free money? How do you sell that policy to people like that?
Quite easily, because the Greens are very proud to be backing all of our families, and we know that our families are doing their best. We know that the ability to live a good, healthy, stable life should not just be limited to the few who are wealthier or better off.
In mid-August, a South Auckland outbreak of coronavirus led the government to announce that Auckland would again be heading into level 4 lockdown, while the rest of the country would operate at level 2.
Many believe that Pacific people, especially here in South Auckland, needed to be aware that the virus was being transmitted among our own.
My word of encouragement to all of us Pacific people, please go and get tested, especially if you have flu-like symptoms. It is very important that we get to the bottom of COVID-19.
Across the Pacific, we looked at the impact of COVID-19 in the Cook Islands and Samoa.
Here on the motu of Ma'ina on the outskirts of Aitutaki is a slice of paradise far from reach of COVID-19.
Pretty much we just had to go back to original roots, planting and fishing, moved away from tourism, just a whole bunch of living off the land, just getting us back to, you know, nature.
From a grassroots level, what's happening out there in the village, out there in the communities?
When I go into the villages and help these families with the groceries, the little that we have to give, I think all of us are trying to figure out ways how to give back to our families. You know, before the pandemic, people were already not having jobs. People already had different issues like domestic violence, sexual abuse. Now, with this happening, it feels like it's 10 times worse.
By late September, Auckland was back at alert level 2, meaning we could continue covering the elections, which had been postponed to October.
One of the things that did come up, of course, was you alluding to your husband being Samoan. What's your response to the backlash that you've had?
Yeah, I was really disgusted, actually. I thought, how dare people try to disrespect my husband
he
like
is Samoan.
That. He is Samoan. Not only is he Samoan, Alistair, he's born in Samoa, raised in Samoa, grew up in a little village on Savai, Papasatawa, and that is, you know, like with his grandma. Mm. How dare people disrespect my husband like that?
We did put $40 million towards supporting specifically our Pacific community with housing because, yes, there's underrepresentation of Pacifica in home ownership. And often families will actually be paying enough in rent that they could be paying off a mortgage.
As we edge closer to election night, we headed out to Mangere and Porirua to give Pacific candidates a final opportunity to convince voters.
You know, current polling is showing that, you know, really Greens are on the cusp. Are you confident, though, that the party can get there above that 5% threshold?
Yes, yeah, I'm confident. 6% actually gets me in, so I'll be more confident if people out there party vote green, because a party vote green is a vote for your cousin Tiano Toyono.
How have you found the campaign so far?
It's been an amazing campaign, but it has been a very long and hard campaign. Look, we've come out of a period of COVID. It's mean that it's sort of hampered us in many ways in terms of some of the normal things that we're doing during campaign. The meet and greet, the public meetings, the community events have not been there. But ultimately, we've been trying to do the best we can to try and get the message out, and actually just to let people know who I am and what I'm about and what I want to do for Mangere.
On election night, Labor's red wave swept the country and introduced four new Pacific MPs, bringing the party's total to 10.
Jubilant celebrations as Labor candidate Barbara Edmonds breaks into a Siva Samoa as confirmation comes through that she has won the Mana electorate.
We weren't taking anything for granted, but the results tonight, both for Mana and for Labor, they're looking promising and actually beyond our expectations.
It's a sea of red here tonight at the Auckland Town Hall. And if things continue that way, it's going to be red, red, red at the Beehive.
I was asking them to back the fact that we want Jacinda to continue as Prime Minister, but we've also got 13 candidates of Pacific heritage, first time ever.
However, it was not a great night for National, which finished with 25% of the votes and the elimination of List MP Alfred Ngaro.
Sort of, in some ways, going to look forward to maybe just stepping away, being an ordinary punter, looking at politics, and then maybe do a Winston Peters and come back in.
Well, I think everyone that I've met that's left politics has always been happier and healthier. You know, they don't miss the robustness of it, but they do miss the people.
Meanwhile, we continue to bring you more stories from our communities up and down the country.
Similar to the life in Samoa over here, living in Bluff, all us, the Samoan community in Bluff. We have our own small Samoan church near Ocean Beach there. I love knowing the people, meeting the people.
As an only child, the passing of his father really hit home.
Well, I was a crying Samoan instead of a laughing Samoan for a while. But it probably made, I believe it made me stronger, but also made me more appreciative of, you know, the time that we do have with loved ones.
As we approach the end of what has been an unusual year, we finished off on a high, celebrating our community heroes during our annual SunPix Awards.
I want to honour you for your leadership, takitaki alofa, for your legacy, te olanga manuia, your sacrifice and your service for our communities. While you've been behind the scenes, your work does not go unnoticed, and tonight we have honoured you.
Wow, it sure was a busy year for us, and fingers crossed things will return back to normal in 2021.
And speaking of 2021, we hope you guys have a great New Year's, and be sure to tune in next week where we'll bring you the first of our TP Plus specials, showcasing highlights from our online platform. Till then, tō whā, sofua.
Wishing you and your family a happy New Year.